I'd like to take us back a little bit. You know, we're past 100 episodes of Gotham now. You guys have got a lot of this under your belts, but both of you have taken on rather legendary mantles with these characters that you're playing, and I wonder if we can go back to getting these parts, auditioning for these parts. What was your relationship with the world of Batman when this project came across your table?
Well, it was a very strange process, a fascinating process, because I've been in the business for many years. I was doing another show called Elementary, and I got this generic speech through about a guy that goes into a pub and gets in a fight and breaks someone's larynx. And I didn't really understand, but I knew that it was written by a Londoner because they got the sort of copy pat absolutely down. So they flew me down, I went on tape, they flew me down to LA. I didn't know what the project was, it was under wraps completely. And I saw Danny Cannon, who I'd done a couple of movies with in the past, and Bruno Heller's sort of known in the past. And I said, so what are you guys doing down here? They said, oh, you're auditioning for us, you idiot. You know, it's, and I said, what's the project called? And they said, it's called Gotham. And I said, well, who am I reading? They went, Alfred Pennyworth. And I sort of thought, that's not the Alfred Pennyworth that I know, that this guy was like a proper bruiser. So we went in and we did this sort of speech, and they said, imagine you've got a 12-year-old kid in the back of the car. And that was the sort of the beginnings of my relationship with the character. They wrote a standalone piece for it, and you could see which direction they were going. And at first, there was gales of disapproval from the hardcore Batman fan base because of my parenting skills.
Yeah, what
are they? Well, I was very brusque, as you can imagine. I mean, he never asked to be a father, he never asked to be a guardian. And he becomes everything, becomes a father and his mentor and his sensei and his best friend. So, you know, that was, we were going to uncharted territory. So it was giving a character, a famous character, a backstory for the first time, which was been a fascinating process. Because normally when you do a movie, you get 90 minutes to tell a story. And we've been given 98 hours to tell our story.
David, what was your relationship with the world of Batman as you were taking on, honestly, I mean, one of the great roles in the world of superheroes?
Yeah, I was kind of really, really, really nervous going into the audition because I really wanted this part. It was Bruce Wayne. What 12-year-old doesn't want to be Bruce Wayne?
I think the answer is that literally every 12-year-old wants to be Bruce Wayne.
So I was included in that. I was no exception, and I knew I was auditioning for Bruce Wayne. I didn't know about the project, and really I didn't really know what it was about. My sides didn't say Bruce on them. They weren't from the script. I had sides. I was talking with presumably a therapist type, or some kind of figure that I was, talking deeply with, and my, whoever I was playing in that audition had his brother died, his older brother died, and he was talking about that the therapist says, is there a memory that you have of your brother that is good, that you kind of want to return to? And he talks about this, had this really long monologue, a page-long monologue, talking about this story with me and my family, and my brother were camping, and me and my brother climbed up a tree, and an eagle landed on the branch, and I was describing this eagle, and it was a really, really emotional pair of sides. And so I auditioned for it, and then it was right before Christmas, so then they kind of took a break, and then 2 weeks later after Christmas break, they said, okay, so we want to see you back, and it was the beginning of January. And when they wanted to be back, I had a 102 fever. So, I didn't really want to be auditioning with a 102 fever, but I went in, and then I was like, okay, well, I'm still pretty sick, but at least that's over with. That night, I get a call, want to see you back tomorrow. And that happened about, I'm not exaggerating, about 4 times in 1 week. So then eventually, they told me that I got it, and I was very relieved. I was very happy. But yeah, it was incredible. I mean, I never thought, as an actor, you're kind of trained to never actually expect that you're going to get anything because you get rejected so much of the time. It's kind of part of auditioning. Like, you audition to audition. You don't actually think you're going to get it. So I was like, so when I got this audition, I was like, oh yeah, it's a cool thing to audition for. And then when I actually got it, I was like, whoa. Wow. that's cool. I'm Bruce Wayne. I looked myself in the mirror, I was like, you're Bruce Wayne. And then I remember the first day of filming, it didn't really sink in the first day of filming. I remember I was getting ready, I was in a hotel on the Lower East Side, and I was getting picked up, and our first day was in Long Island. It was when Bruce is like standing on the roof and Alfred screams at him to come down. That was our first day on set, my first day on set, I think it was yours too. I was getting ready to be picked up, and I was like getting ready in the bathroom. And then I just started jumping on the bed for 20 minutes. Because I had so much excited energy that I knew I needed to get out, because I knew I needed to be professional on set. But yeah, I can't even describe how ecstatic I was.
I've got a couple more for you guys. I don't want to be selfish and take up all the time. We have a Q&A mic set up right here. Go ahead and start lining up. If you got questions, trust me, I like doing my job, but I also like being lazy. So go ahead and start lining up. As I said, taking on the mantles of two legendary characters, a number of people have come before you playing these characters. You do a bunch of these conventions. I'm curious if maybe, David, you've run into, you know, guys like Kevin Conroy, Val Kilmer, other guys who have worn the cowl, as it were, in different respects. Have you crossed paths with other people that have played your roles in other iterations of the Batman franchise?
Unfortunately, I've never. I've met one Batman. I met Ben Affleck at the Batman vs Superman premiere party. There's a lot of peas in that. I only met him for about 15 seconds, so we didn't have a very long conversation. And I've seen Val Kilmer at some distances. I have had some conventions. I haven't had the chance to meet him, but hopefully before, before the opportunity is over, yeah, I'll be able to meet somebody else and talk to them about what it's like to. I mean, I can only talk to them. Well, actually, you know, I'm not gonna spoil anything. Yeah, I'm gonna leave it at that.
Yeah, we're not gonna spoil anything.
I met Christian Bale, actually, just reminded myself that there was this film called Swing Kids when he was about 14. Yeah, man, you know, I forgot about that. Yeah. Two different Nazis in it. And I did another film with him called Equilibrium. So it was prior to him knowing that he was going to be the best man, other than this one's Christmas. Sir Michael very briefly with my friend Jude, and that's it. No, I haven't met any other iterations.
Well, we gotta get a reunion together for you guys. Get everybody together.
I think we should have an Alfred off. You know what I mean? Jeremy Irons and I should take it to the car park. I'll take my money to the movie.
So I've got one more for you, then we're gonna turn it over to the audience because they're the reason that we're here. You've done, like I said, over 100 episodes of Gotham, lots of twists, lots of turns, lots of crazy stuff that's happened. You talked about the secrecy just doing the audition. I wonder how that secrecy has progressed over the course of the show. Are there twists and turns that happened that you were really, you were maybe unaware of until you actually saw the episode as it was ready to air? How incredibly secretive are they about the further progress of the show?
I don't know if they're secretive or they're surprised themselves. I mean, God knows what goes on in the writers' room. I know Davi's been in there. I haven't been into the black hole of Calcutta kind of thing. I mean, so we don't know. We often, it's always been a huge plus of our company. I don't know if you lovely people have met the rest of our cast, but we're a very tight-knit unit. We're very close to each other. And what's kept us close and kept the world really alive is that we do table reads, which is something that they don't normally do. So Ben started, our ship's captain, Ben McKenzie, sort of started the idea that we come in, even if we're shooting, we'll all come in from wherever we are to do a table read, which has kept us incredibly tight together. And often, because we shoot 22 episodes in a season, or we did, we're shooting 10 this time, but we find out which way, which direction we're going. And it's a surprise, because that's the nature of the show at Gotham, is it's based in a sort of arched form of reality. So, you know, who knows which way the writers will take us. You know, everyone has, I've said this before, has a propensity to love or be violent or be bad or be good. And that's what's the enduring legacy, I think, of our show, our interpretation of Batman.
Any anything in particular that, that you've especially relished doing in the roles that you're doing, whether it's maybe a little bit of stunt work, whether it's a particularly memorable scene for you that you really enjoyed sinking your teeth into doing the show so far? Do you have that? I mean, you know, maybe almost going back to jumping on the bed before doing your first scene, but do you have one of those kinds of memories from making the show?
I feel like those kinds of memories are made every other week on Gotham. I'm so thankful. There are not a lot of, you know, when I was auditioning for Gotham, I was just kind of, just starting to cross the puberty line. And, seriously, this is
a very precise way to put it, too.
This is a thing in like the child actor world. Once a boy starts kind of creeping up on 13, the roles start getting weird. Either weird, oddly sexual, or really boring and, you know, not interesting. And Gotham obviously is none of that. And I'm so thankful to get one of the only roles for somebody my age that I'm constantly, week after week, challenged and able to really work on my acting craft and work with people like Sean, who I learned so much from. And we have some of the best actors on our show, some of the best everything on the show. Every one of our directors crew people are all top notch, and I'm constantly being challenged and able to perfect what I do. If I had to pick some specific moments, I think one of the first scenes that I really felt was kind of out of the box for me, something that I was excited to do and nervous to do, was the scene where Bruce and Alfred go up to Tommy Elliott's house in season one and punch him in the face. You guys know what I mean. Yeah, but like I said, it's so tough to pick moments because I really like, you know, we just did a fight scene that Thursday, 2 days ago, that I found kind of difficult when we did it, but you know, everyone was like, oh, it looks great. I don't know. I feel like I'm constantly being challenged in different ways.
I go along with David. I mean, I'm lucky enough that our showrunners allowed me to do my own fights and stuff because I love doing that. I'm throwing myself. My wife hates it when I do it. So I bounce like I used to, you know. Bruise and play. I absolutely love it. Anything they won't let me do is go through glass or anything to landing on your neck, which is kind of handy, really. But I've been lucky enough to do all of those fights and scenes, and he's got a vicious right hook now, which is really good. I learned him well. So I love doing the fights, but I also it was great seeing that stuff back and how much I've watched this remarkable, I think you agree with me, remarkable young man. I spent a lot of time away from my own son called Alfred, and I'm blessed enough to spend time with this remarkable gentleman. And for me, it's the quiet scenes that we've had together have been the most sort of poignant and moving, because it's kind of question of no acting required, really, when I work with David. David and I, you know, I've sort of grown with this young man, and he's turned out to be an absolute delight. So I love those quiet sequences, like when he decides he gets to the mantra, thou shalt not kill, that thing. I love that scene. I love the scene, the fact that when he kills him, he loves him so much that to snap him out of his mental state, he stabs him, that's how much he loves his character. Those moments I've enjoyed the most, actually.
Go for it.
I'd like to say thanks to the two of you. It's been a pleasure listening.
Doesn't sound like that was working, so I'm going to jump over here. How's it going?
Morning. It's been a pleasure listening to both of you.
Thank you.
I have a question to you, Mr. Perkley.
Yeah.
I've been fortunate enough to see your father perpetuating characters, characters of very obscure BBC science fiction program. I see them help create perpetuate iconic figures in the history of entertainment.
Thank you. Yeah.
I also was very fortunate for a number of years ago to catch you in one of those Miss Marple mysteries and play a character with mommy issues.
Yeah.
So my question is this: Did you run into a lot of difficulty when you started your career as an actor, trying to convince producers that you were Sean Perkley the actor, not the doctor's son?
That's actually an amazing question.
I think that's the title of your memoir, The Son of the Doctor.
It was an amazing thing, because my father, if you don't know, my father was Doctor Who, he was the third Doctor. He came from an extraordinary legacy. You know, our family had been involved in the industry for about 200 years. We were Huguenots, and they were actors from ballet dancers back in the day. And his father was a Noel Coward acolyte, and he used to write with Noel Coward, and he was one of the first writers in Hollywood, Roland Pertwee. So he had the same issues. He went off to war, and got blown up about five times, and stuff. And when he came back, he wanted to prove and cut his teeth on his own. He was terrified of nepotism, wanted to do it on his own. And he was, if ever you knew him, he was an extraordinary character. And he was an antithesis, an anathema to what was of the day. He was gangly, he had a lisp, he was punchy, he was aggressive, but Campus Christmas. I mean, he was this kind of, he was an extraordinary ball of energy, my father. So when it came to me being an actor, I did the exact same thing. I left home when I was 15, although I loved him deeply, and we were incredibly close. I left home when I was 15 and worked in kitchens, and I didn't even tell him that I was auditioning for drama schools, because we have a very different system in England. You have to be go to accredited drama school to be able to allow to work on film or in the theatre. So he got a telex from me when I got into RADA and got into Central and got into Bristol, which is the school I wanted to go to, because I wanted to make mistakes. So I sent him a telegram, and he was on a cruise, and it said, "I'm in, love, Shawnee." And he read it, he went, "I don't know what the fuck he's talking about. I'm in love, Shawnee." He said, "Why is he texting me? Telexing me, saying I'm in love." So anyway, so that's when he first found out that I was serious about becoming an actor, because I'm in love, Shawnee.
Thank you.
Nasty in real life.
Yeah, is that what they are? Like, you know, playful and asses in real life, or are they, you know, jokesters, you know?
They're the nicest guys. I'm really, really upset that I wasn't able to work with them more. I've had a couple of scenes with Penguin now in season 4, which I was really, really thrilled about, and they were so much fun to do. It was so much fun to just be on set with Robin, because, you know, like Sean said, because of the table reads and because of, you know, the press stuff, the conventions that we do, we are very, very close. Even though we never work together, we're never on set together. But we all know each other so well. We all spend so much time together. So to be able to, you know, see like Robin, who I know is just like, you know, my work friend, actually work with him, it's a whole other experience. I've gotten to do one kind of half scene with Corey, who plays Enigma. At the end of season 2, but he was on the other side of a piece of glass. If you've seen that, if you guys have seen it, you know what I'm talking about. Somebody does. So yeah, but still, not enough. I really wanted it could still happen. You never know. But I really want a really good arc with one of them. But no, they're not evil. At all.
None of them notorious pranksters or anything like that.
No, sorry, but it's a really weird thing, and we talked about this before, actually, it's a good point, that we shoot an episode in 8 days, which is kind of phenomenal because you think of the scale and the size of it. Although we're incredibly close, you have to turn up with your A game, you know, so there's not a lot of pranking goes on because everyone's so good. I remember when we did our first little scene with Robin, I got nervous. It was kind of the weirdest thing. It was just, although I wanted to work with him, and so did he. Because the thing is, our worlds haven't collided. And when you're there, and you're sort of in awe of these characters as well, you've got to understand, you don't want to let the team down, you know? So we take our work very seriously, and that's another attribute of our cast and our crew, is we take our work very seriously, although we're incredibly close. The one person I can't look at is Chris Chalk, who plays Lucius Fox. He just makes me laugh. So whenever you see him in the scene with David, we're always looking at him.
Awesome. No, yeah, Sean is so right. I remember in season one, it wasn't a real scene with Robin. I don't know if you guys remember, but it was the scene where Brooke is like walking into a gun range. And it was like a kind of a cool cameo thing that they did where I was walking in and then the camera tilts up and you see Penguin walking by me. We don't talk to each other, but we were both on set the same day, and that was the first time that I was on set with him. But you know, the show had been on for about a season, and I remember looking at Robin. The show had been airing, I saw what he was doing, but I remember seeing him limp for the first time in person.
Yeah.
And it was weird. Like, it doesn't sound like it should be that weird, but I remember, whoa, that's Penguin. He's right there. I had like a mini fangirl moment because I realized I'd never worked with Penguin. I saw Penguin on my TV, but the two things weren't ever together. It was strange.
You're worrying me now.
Yeah.
This question's for the both of you. The dreaded question. Where can we see your characters going in season 5? And then where can we see you two after Gotham ends? Can you give us any hints on that?
So it sounds like the first question is, how much do you like your jobs?
Yeah.
Second question, you know, what do you see yourselves doing, you know, once you're done with Gotham? That we want it to go on forever, right?
Yes.
I see myself petitioning for a Gotham season 6. Well, Gotham season 5 is, I think I can confidently say, probably will be the best season of Gotham yet.
Yeah.
It's shorter, which means it's juicier, much more to pack in each episode, and it's really my favorite thing about it. I mean, it's no man's land. Just to give some backdrop, it's no man's land. I think we pick up about 3 months after season 4 ends, is where season 5 begins, and everybody is kind of in this state of crazy manic, and just trying. Everybody's just kind of tired and just trying to. Working around the clock, helping people out, taking the bad guys down. You know how it is in Gotham. And but what I was gonna say is my favorite thing about it is that it's really real. It's very, we really get to know our characters. It's not like there's a villain of the week and everybody's gonna try to stop him. It's more, it's much more character based, and it's much more gritty, and it's much more real, and it's much more human. And I really have enjoyed that. I've enjoyed playing with it. I've enjoyed reading those scripts. And it really moves. And you're going to get to see some things that I know a lot of people have been asking me about. You guys can probably guess what I'm talking about. Since the show has begun. And I didn't have an honest answer. So I would usually say I don't know or make up some snarky thing because I didn't know. But now I do know. And now... tell you, Batman fans will not be disappointed.
Woo!
And in regards to After Gotham, for me it's just, I mean, hopefully something else comes along. That's pretty much it. School.
Season 5 is going to be, he's right, it's going to be amazing. I think Fox and Warner Brothers are going to realize they've done a major boo-boo. I really genuinely mean it. We did a scene the other day, and I just looked around me, and then sort of the enormity of what we were doing, and the sets, and the costume department have gone ballistic. They're nuts. It's just incredible being on a set like that. I've been acting for a very long time, and I've very rarely been on a film set of that magnitude. And the attention to detail, you know, go to the GCPD, and you pick up a newspaper, there's an article about the characters, about Penguin or something, in the newspaper, daily newspaper. It's just extraordinary. And it's just that, you know, that's the first bit done. Now the second bit, what was the second question? After Gotham. Yeah, so after Gotham.
Equilibrium 2.
Well, I hope not. Yeah. But I'm working with Neil Marshall, who directed a film I did called Dog Soldiers, and he does Game of Thrones and stuff like that. And I had written a script, he rang me the other day, and he offered me the sort of second lead in this movie called Malphitia, which is about the plague and about witchcraft and what they used to, which finer generals used to do to people when they thought they were witches, which wasn't very pleasant. So that's a little sort of Jacob's Laddery and dark. And then I'm doing another film, which is directed by a friend called, that Neil's actually producing as well, called Kruger, which is about a family who get lost in Kruger National Game Reserve in South Africa and get attacked. And that's a wicked script, so we tried to do that for about 7 years, so we're doing that next year. Thank you.
And then hopefully Netflix picks up Gotham, and then we get a season 6, right?
So if people want to support the show and support the notion of it going on into infinity, the best thing they can do is show all kinds of love for it on social media, maybe? Maybe that's a good idea? Yeah?
Okay, so first off, Sean, thank you for showing me that somebody other than Michael Caine is allowed to play Alfred and do it well. Yeah. And then also showing me why I was so connected to that particular character. And with that, I think everybody who watched Gotham had some idea of what Batman or Alfred is supposed to be, whether that be a movie or a comic arc. So when you guys are playing these characters, especially you, being Bruce Wayne, who doesn't know that he's going to be Batman, did you ever have some conflict where you're like, you have these ideas of what these characters are supposed to be down the line, but your characters don't know that yet? Does that kind of make sense?
I think I kind of thought that was going to be a problem, but the writing is so incredible. You kind of just get lost in the characters that the page presents to you, because, you know, I didn't see when I first started reading the scripts, and this became more true as season one and season two and everything kind of went on. I knew Bruce, I knew Gotham's Bruce, I knew my Bruce, and also you don't want to see the same people rehashed over and over and over again. These are slightly different characters than we've seen, like every incarnation of Batman is. Every incarnation, every comic book is gonna have characters that are a little bit different than the last movie or the last book or the last animated series. And I think it's supposed to be like that. And you know, Gotham, I'm sure you guys know, Gotham is no exception. We have origin stories that are different than what's been seen. But when I think of Bruce, I don't think of kid who's gonna be Batman. I think of the kid who had his parents killed, who was determined to find their killer, who chose not to kill their killer, who has an amazing relationship with his butler slash friend slash father figure. I think of all these things. I don't think of kid who will be Batman because I've been stepping in this guy's shoes literally. I see the character that we've built from the ground up with, and it's really all due to the writers. They like I said, they paint such a vivid picture on the page that I just have to kind of put it in a body. That's how I feel.
We've got about 15 minutes left. I think we're going to get to everybody in line. So everybody who's in line, we should be able to get to you, including you, guy who just snuck up in the back. Go ahead.
The show or reading Batman comics, do you think they would have a favorite villain, and who do you think it would be?
Oh gosh.
Sean's trying to bend his mind around. Alfred would like one of the villains.
No, he doesn't like anyone. I think that's the problem.
I mean, Bruce doesn't like his villains. By default, they're his villains.
At the same time, he's kind of fascinated by them, obsessed with them.
Well, he could have gone one way or the other, couldn't he, really? He could have been a villain himself, and he was nearly turned in Gotham by my friend Reggie, so he could have gone to the dark side very easily.
Absolutely.
You know?
As a character, do you think that there's one of them that maybe Bruce saw as he respected as a formidable enemy, an opposing force, that kind of thing?
I think he respects them all. It's tricky.
That's the most Bruce Wayne answer of all.
it's tricky because Bruce doesn't, I mean, at least on Gotham, he hasn't really had his own kind of rogues gallery. Really, like the Valeska twins are his rogues gallery on Gotham. He hasn't really built it up yet. Like he hasn't, like I said, had scenes with Robin, Penguin. So like, you know, he's not really a villain to Bruce. He's more a villain to the good guy entity of the show. I'm really trying to answer your question.
Yeah, well,
I'm trying not to stray. I'm really trying to think.
Yeah, it's almost like shifting the perspective to if Bruce had the, you know, the future like back computer view of all of this stuff that as a character he doesn't have, knowing the character as well as you do, you know, is there one of them that you think he would find the most interesting, the most intriguing if he had that kind of omniscient view of things? I mean, you do watch the show.
Just say Penguin.
No. I'm gonna take the cheap way. I'm gonna go Sean's way. I'm sorry. I can't think of it.
Nice.
But you know what? I will think about it.
He's gonna be thinking about it.
I'm gonna be thinking about it in the shower. I'm gonna be thinking about it at my table.
First off, I gotta say, I love y'all's take on the characters. It's absolutely amazing. I love just about every aspect of the show. I have not been disappointed. The changes that they've made with the characters, I think, have flowed so beautifully. So I kind of have a two-part question. My first part is, personally, what villain do you like from the show? And second, what villain would you like to see in your show?
Everybody loves villains too.
I think I know what you want me to say.
Yeah.
Harley Quinn.
You are Harley Quinn, but I mean from a personal take, personally, who would both of y'all like from the villains and who do you want to maybe see?
Well, I mean, sort of seen him, but I didn't see that we didn't explore it further. I really like Clayface. I used to really like that character. Really, Clayface. But I, you know, I'm sorry, but we have such good villains anyway at the moment. You know, I adore Robin's Penguin, and I adore Corey's Riddler, and adore the Jeremiah Jerome twins thing. You know, I think we're going to have to sort of edge towards the Joker at some point, really, because he is the ultimate. If anything, if in my opinion, he's almost like the carbon opposite of Bruce. He's the same intellect, and that's the terrifying aspect, isn't it? Someone who's intelligent and psychopathic at the same time. Yeah. Got all over you, mate.
Yeah, to be completely honest, I want to see a full-fledged Joker. That's what I want to see.
Yeah.
I don't really think we need a new villain. I mean, I would love to see Harley Quinn. I would love to see Killer Croc, just because I like them. I like reading about them in the comics. But what I really want to see is a full-fledged Joker,
yeah.
And see the, like Sean said, the complete dichotomy between the Joker and Bruce Wayne.
Yeah.
They're so different. I mean, like, yeah, they are opposite. Like, everything about them is, I could go on. Joker.
Thank you.
Yeah, he's given a little bit of thought to the Joker. This guy.
First, I want to say I thought you both nailed it way back in season one. I was going to ask two questions. One, you all seem very optimistic about season 6 being picked up or renewed. That's the future. So I was going to ask about that. And second, is Two-Face ever going to show up? Have you already done in the first two seasons?
I don't think Two-Face will show up again. He was sort of in the beginning for the season. When Dent sort of turned up the proto Two-Face, but they didn't explore that further. And in answer to your first question, it's about season 6. I'm really not sure. You know, unless it's a huge swell when the show comes out and is aired, which we don't know when it actually is going to be aired. We know it's going to be next year. We'll have to wait and see. You know, we'll see. They're doing a spin-off show actually with Pennyworth, but not with me. But Danny Cannon and Bruno Heller are about to shoot that. So that's another part of the universe.
Yeah, I think with the Harvey Dent thing, I think the show kind of had to, because there are so many Batman characters, even though we have 22 episodes a season, there is a limited amount of time, and I think think the show kind of had to make a choice between getting really in-depth into a handful of characters or getting medium depth into all the Batman characters, all 300,000 of them. And I think they made the wise choice of, you know, picking characters like Bruce Wayne, Alfred, Gordon, Selina, Penguin, Ed, and really understanding them, really knowing what brought them from being quote-unquote normal to being these over-animated characters, heroes, villains, etc. And so I think people like Harvey Dent, who appeared in season two, are kind of there just to remind the Batman audience that we are living in this world, and these people will come out eventually once, you know, post-Gotham era, once Batman is Batman. Kind of teasing them and reminding. I think that they're kind of just reminders to people that we're living in Gotham and these characters are out there. But I think the reason that we didn't explore people like that is because we chose to explore people like me. You know?
Did any of the villains in Gotham put on such a good performance that they actually managed to terrify you in any way?
How scary is Robert Lord Taylor?
He's so not scary. I mean, his performance is terrifying. I found Nigma actually in the season as he develops because he suffers from mental illness. And Corey, I think so many more actors deserve awards anyway, but I think that Corey managed the dual personality disorder impeccably well, and I found him terrifying. But what I really liked about the development of these sort of super, that they become super villains, is it was based in a form of reality that, you know, you don't push or bully a young, intelligent man like Oswald Cobblepot too much, because you could be sitting next to someone like Oswald, you push, and then when they snap, they turn into a vicious killer, so be nice to your neighbor, basically. You know what I mean? It's a good sort of adage for our show, and the same thing with the way Corey approached very seriously the role of Edward Nygma. He was researched deeply into mental health issues and the disease of split personality and everything like that. And he approached it from that angle and would shout down any sort of tapping towards a sort of Jim Carrey-esque Riddler. It was deeply seated in a form of reality that this man was sick and all he ever tried to do was be present. But he was just just left of center, you know. He's an original, as they say. And so I love that development of these characters being pushed and given the time and space to being pushed to becoming these characters that are full-blown villains.
Style cancer. Are we still going? A few minutes left, I think we'll get through all three of you. Go for it.
Was it like playing as your characters in Gotham?
What's it like? I mean, do you you put on the costume and it you go through a transformation process? Is it subtler than that?
I think I do. I think Robin always says when he puts on the nose, he feels like a different person. He has a prosthetic nose. His nose isn't that big.
That's not real.
And I think it's very true. Once I get my hair done, I look all spiffy and I'm wearing my $500,000 Brooks Brothers suit. I do feel like a different person, and it's been crazy. I mean, playing at first, the appeal of playing somebody like Bruce Wayne is Bruce Wayne. He's gonna be Batman. It's pretty cool. And coming at it from a fan point of view, because I'm a fan of this mythos myself. But as the show has progressed, I've loved playing the character more and more, not because of his relation to the Batman universe, but because of how complex, how rich this character actually is, how deep and complicated this young man is, the decisions that he chooses to make, what's going on in his head are things that I find fascinating to explore as a person and as an actor. So I think that's my favorite thing about playing Bruce Wayne.
Yeah, no, mine is the fact that I think he's one of the only Englishmen that I know in the superhero sort of universe other than Constantine. You know, I don't think there's, and that's the point for me. amazed. Like, everyone always knew who Alfred was, and to be able to flesh him out and give him physicality, and make him, that's a native New Yorker song, that police song, that Sting did, and it's that thing that he uses his language. He's the odd one out. He uses his language as a threat and everything like that. And I love the fact that the studio has let me put in a lot of my own sort of dialogue, which is, that's the whole idea. He uses language as a weapon. So to be able to be truly English, like truly Cockney, and put in words, stuff that you may not understand, is the whole point. That's been a huge plus for me, because it's definitely given me a stamp on the Alfred legacy going forward, that I've given him a voice. So that I'm incredibly proud of.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
All right, first of all, I love your show. It's awesome. Reminds me of like the Dark Knight movies. They're realistic and it just straight up makes sense. My question is, what were the most fun scenes for you two to play?
What's the most fun? The $500,000 Brooks Brothers suit?
Yes. Take those home.
I mean, they might just fall off of a truck, who knows?
I love doing the fights. I think I've said that before, but I love doing the fights. I've been lucky enough to do some huge ones with Jessica Lucas. We did a great fight. And what was extraordinary was that, I don't know if you remember, she had a wig and we had this big fight, this dagger, and she stabs me and goes on for hours. And I was allowed to do the whole thing, including running out of this building. And Jessica had this kind of weird cookery knife thing, this sort of semi-moon shaped knife, and she threw it. And I'm not kidding you, I jumped on the back of a moving garbage truck, and she threw this thing and it arced perfectly and hit me right in the back of the shoulders. And it was amazing, and the moving truck is about as far away as, like, 25, 30 feet, she threw this thing and it hit me. And it's all on film. So that's the kind of stuff I love doing, is the physicality. That's the one I enjoy the most.
And then you spent 3 weeks in the hospital.
Yeah. And you stabbed me.
He spent 3 years in the
hospital.
All right, we have one more from the audience, and then I got one to wrap us up. What do you got?
Hey.
I was wondering, what is real life actor on TV show Gotham?
Sorry, I had trouble hearing you. Could you repeat that for me?
I was wondering what is real life actress on the Gotham.
What's it like to be an actor on Gotham? How does being on Gotham, how is it different than other sets that you've been on? What is it that makes being on the Gotham set distinct for you?
It's the enormity of it. It's when you, if you ever were lucky enough to invite you went for a cup of tea to the Manor, just everything is palpable. It's just like the Manor, you know, I walk into our set in the Manor and it's like home, it really is. It's just beautiful. It's just the scale of everything. The attention to detail, and all of our heads of department, from makeup to hair, Teresa, I mean, the haircuts, right? Wow, which is like crazy. It's just, it's true art, and it's that very rarely happens where, you know, love it or hate it. The thing is, everyone has an idea of Gotham in their head. I know I have, and ours is like Taxi Driver. So it's like kind of a bizarre Taxi Driver meets the, I don't know, Brothers Grimm. Do you know what I mean? It's like it's our style, and I'm very proud that we put our flag in the sand for this generation of our interpretation of the legacy of Batman, which has been going for 80 years.
Yeah, I think the caliber of the show, I mean, it's exactly, I was going to say exactly what Sean did. Being on this set is different because everybody is so good at what they do. So like, it's so true. You have to bring your A game. You really have to come prepared. You have to.
I mean, if you're doing this story, if you're doing these stories, you have to be at that level.
I'm constantly, consistently, without doubt, every time, so impressed by everybody that comes on set. I was just talking to one of our directors, who I love, one of my favorite directors, Mark Tondorai. Is that his last name? And he was telling me.
Say it quickly.
Yeah. Mark, I know him as Mark. He's phenomenal. He was telling me about the episode. He was breaking down. He said the common theme in this episode that we were just shooting is betrayal. Everybody has that in their storylines. You know how Gotham is. There's always 16 different storylines going on in one episode. And but this theme was present in all of them, and I thought about it, and I was like, oh, you're absolutely right. And so he sent me his lookbook where he kind of has so we were shooting a scene in the Sirens, and he was shooting it with a lot of shadows, and he said, you know, the shadows are to represent the betrayal that you're feeling in this scene, and there are things hiding in the shadows, there are things that you're finding out that are coming to light now that you didn't know before. And he said, we're shooting a scene with Penguin and somebody else, I don't want to spoil anything, that scene is just two honest men talking to each other, so we lit it like that. There are no lot of shadows. I was blown away by that attention to art and to detail. And that's something that everybody consistently brings to their show, and that's why it's different. And that's why you can see it when you watch the show. When you watch the show, the quality is so phenomenal. And I'm constantly in awe of everybody on the set, constantly.
Wonderful questions from the audience. You guys do so much better job than I do. And actually, with deference to our audience, to these people that come and see you guys at conventions, we talked earlier about going back to when you were auditioning for these parts. And I'd like to go back to a different point. Once the show was out and you did the first one of these conventions, once the fans were actually seeing the show, what was that experience like for you? I feel like it's probably something that's pretty distinct for you. Interacting with the fans once the show was actually out. What was that experience like, being in front of all these lovely people for the first time?
Well, the thing was, is because it's, again, Gotham, the idea behind it is how the city shapes and molds people to become who they later become. So it was, it didn't sit quite right to begin with. It was a difficult one because, like I sort of said before, everyone has an opinion about this universe, quite rightly so, but everyone is passionate about that. And I think we needed to sort of cut our teeth and allow people to trust us in the driving seat to develop these characters to who they were to become through subtext and through developing them and people in their legions. And I have to say, it's becoming more and more popular. That's what's so sad about it drawing to an end, is that it's becoming more increasingly popular because people sort of understand and respect our interpretation. So at first it was a mixed bag, wasn't it, Dee? It was when we first came to this convention. So, you know, it's just an honor. You guys are mind-blowing. I swear to God, it's an honor to be one part of the legacy, but to be supported and to be such talent as well with you guys, with the sort of fan base, the fan art, the videos, the inventiveness, and to be accepted by you is a true honor. I genuinely mean that. So thank you.
What was going out into that convention hall the first time like for you? Were you as nervous as you were going into that first scene, you know, facing the public for the first time?
I'm gonna rephrase your question. That wasn't the right word.
Look, I'm gonna let Bruce Wayne do whatever he wants.
Because the moment that I realized the scope of the show was San Diego Comic-Con, and that was before the show aired. We were shooting episode 3. Only thing the public had seen was a 3-minute trailer. And we were having huge lines of people that wanted an autograph. And I just was thinking, what if you don't like the show? You don't know if you're my fan yet. You haven't seen anything I've done.
I'm sorry, fans come up on stage and demand an audience.
I thought I was just like making a funny joke. You guys laughed. This is my dog, Starlet. She has an Instagram account now.
She does, yeah.
A week ago. @Superstar, get your phones out, take a picture, tag her, photos. She wants to see photos of her. She dresses her. See, this is why I love conventions. This moment right here. Thank you, guys.
How have things evolved? You know, as Sean was saying, as the show has gone on, as more and more popular support has come behind the show, what has it been like interacting with the audience now that everybody's on board, now that Starlet's on board? What's What's it been like, you know, as the popularity of the show has grown here over time?
It's been phenomenal. I mean, the reason I love these conventions is because you guys, without you, the show, I mean, very obviously doesn't exist. It's for you that we make it. It's because of you that we continue to make it. I love just talking to people, finding out what they like and what they don't like about it, and kind of adjusting for that.
She just took all of the spotlight. Like we had a whole thing going. She shows up. She's like, you know, the real star of the show is me. I'm here now. Now, if I could ask a favor of all of you, we've got a really wonderful crew that is making this show work. That is making fantastic things like, you know, the dog running on stage happen without attention. Can we get a round of applause for the crew? Make sure that you go see them. Start with one of the
microphones.
So let's blow the roof off this place one more time for Sean Fernsby.